It's great to see him back in the mParticle world and created something exciting. It's huge. I saw you when you were just one guy, mParticle, you and a couple Interclick guys. And
that's right.
And here you are now presenting on the stage. So good job, man.
Thanks for having us. Hey, everybody. It's good to see some familiar faces here. Let's see. Okay, so I am here to talk about CDPs, and I know what most of you who are not familiar with the acronym is thinking is, yeah, just another acronym. But hopefully by the end of the conversation, I'll convince you that it's not just another acronym, but it's a revolution. Now this slide actually pains me a bit. My last company, Interclick, was the first client of Blue Kai. So DMPs have been near and dear to my heart for a while. But actually, this conversation, this talk, this presentation is not about the death of the DMPs so much as it is talking about the change that's happening really all around us and the change that's creating a new wave of data and a new need for innovative data management solutions and all the challenges and opportunities that come along with that. And ultimately, why the customer data platform really is the only solution going forward. So call it a 360-degree view of the customer, or a holistic customer view, or CRM. I mean, the notion of understanding the customer as completely as possible has been a key issue for marketers since probably the beginning of time, certainly since database marketing. But this has been almost nearly impossible for a number of technological reasons, as well as a number of political reasons. And this isn't about pixeling a bunch of creatives and getting the social data with the video data and the ad data to kind of paint this picture that you've probably seen for the past 10 years. This is about truly understanding the customer, what they're doing on all the different platforms and devices and screens that they interact with and engage with your brand on and across. And so why now? Because ultimately, data platforms are nothing new. Data platforms have been around for 30 plus years. I mean, dating back to before the commercialization of the internet. Why now? Ultimately, the world has changed. And I'd argue that the change from web to app and this true omnichannel experience is as big of a change as moving first from analog to digital. But then secondly, I'd also argue that CDPs are not competitive with DMPs. Much like you wouldn't use a marketing database to try to do what a DMP did for so many years, you really can't get a DMP to do what you need a CDP to do. And the interesting thing is, while a lot of people will view this as incremental change, it's really anything but. So, this slide is really about, really three or four technical or technological revolutions that have happened on the consumer side. But the thing is, most new products are met with a fair degree of skepticism and cynicism before they get mainstream adoption. And why? It's because, most customers are cynical about new technology. They also think that there's still a lot of life left in the previous paradigm. And the new paradigm is somewhat unproven. So if people are seeing even a little bit of success in the last wave of technology, they're gonna be first to dismiss the new technology. And a great example of this happened when we shifted from typewriters to word processors in the workforce. It was adopted first by the legal professionals and people who are doing a lot of templated work, a lot of law firms and government agencies, and ultimately we saw what happened. People weren't still using typewriters. It's weird to actually see a typewriter today. But that change is inevitable, and if anybody's read Jeffrey Moore's book, Crossing the Chasm, you know that there's a continuum of technology buyers and adopters. And so while a select few, including a lot of the customers that we have, are adopting the future today, a lot of people are quick to dismiss new technology and say, it's expensive, it's a luxury, it's not going to be the mainstream. But as the late great poet Christopher Wallace said, things done changed. And it's not just one or two things. There's a handful of significant changes that are happening around us, which are changing the need from the DMP to the CDP, which also create an opportunity to create that single view of the customer. And so since this is industry preview, I really just want to touch upon five key themes that ultimately converge upon one theme, which is the customer. So the digital experience has changed. First, it's no longer single-threaded. Most people, I assume we probably skew towards the higher end here, but most people have a minimum of 6 connected devices, which means that the customer journey is completely fragmented. It also means that people are connected all the time. The first 15 years of the mainstream web, the only way to interact with a brand digitally, you went to their website or you didn't. But that paradigm has totally changed. You know, first, starting with mobile, you could interact with a brand's mobile web property or download their mobile app, and then that's extended into the living room with OTT. I think we'd all probably agree that the next big platform is probably going to be voice, and then AR and VR. And so you can see as this customer experience continues to become fragmented, ultimately there becomes a greater need to centralize the data. Because with all this device hopping, ultimately the customer journey is nonlinear. And the expectation from customers today, I mean, I have this expectation myself. When I start a purchase process on one device or on one platform or one medium, that when I drop off and I pick it up on a completely different platform or medium, that brand knows exactly where I left off and it knows exactly where it needs to pick up. I think anything short of that is completely intolerable. And so ultimately, DMPs were really never built for this, right? You may start your research on buying a new product or a service on your laptop at work. You may pick that up on your commute home. You may think about it for a couple days. You may end up downloading the app upon registration. You get signed up for their email newsletter. You get an email, you know, maybe the next day or a couple days later with some sort of promotion. You get brought back into the app and you complete the purchase. And now that data has touched 4 or 5 different systems, plus all the different vendors that they use to measure and engage users. The data is probably sitting in 20 different systems at that point. So that's a huge change. But the next change is probably the biggest one that I'll talk about. There's probably no more important topic that I'll talk about today, and no more important topic in the industry than identity today. I think identity is going to dominate the headlines in 2018 more so than any other topic. And as we shift to this multi-device reality that ultimately ties to these persistent device IDs, there's a certain place for anonymous behavior and anonymity, and that's typically at the top of the funnel. But the shift from anonymity and anonymity only to identity-based experience, I would argue that is as big of a shift as the shift from analog to digital. Because ultimately what identity brings is stability. Right? You don't have to worry about people deleting their cookies. And I know this is super tactical, but it provides the foundation to bring stability and accountability and predictability and repeatability. And it also means, through identity, that you can start to target people and not proxies. And identity is it's a bit of a convoluted concept. It's used in so many contexts across this industry and others. And I think people just think about identity in the context of matching, but there's actually so much more to it. And so with the emergence of all these different devices, you actually have lots of different forms of identity which need to be governed and managed lots of different ways. And managing identity along this continuum, you have to account for the differences in, you know, technical and geographical and organizational and political contexts. You also have to assume that identity keys are not static, right? I have multiple email addresses. I change my credit card info all the time, my social handles, multiple social handles. So if you're not accounting for this stuff in your identity strategy, you're not going to be able to deliver the optimal customer experience across all these different platforms. And then the other thing, too, is that you really have to think about identity as a framework. It's what allows you to deliver a unified customer experience across all these different devices. It's what allows you to create a holistic view of the customer. It's what everything gets keyed off of. It's what allows you to combine paid ads and retention marketing strategy so everything is not siloed and you can deliver that unified experience, unified marketing experience. It's also what allows you to solve for GDPR, which I'll talk about in a sec. So the third big trend that's been pretty well underway, really should be no surprise to anybody here, but it's definitely picking up steam in the enterprise, especially as some of those more brutal 7 to 10 year contracts that the big legacy tech vendors try to get people locked into are coming to an expiration over the next couple of years. Money and resources is being shifted to the cloud. And again, I'm not telling you anything you don't know. But the budget for SaaS tools is quickly following. An estimated 45% of all corporate spending is going to be on SaaS tools. And so, I think nowhere is this growth more apparent than the marketing tech landscape. And so we've all seen the Loom escapes in various forms and formats, but they're dwarfed by the marketing tech landscape that the chief MarTech has been producing over the past few years. And the point I would just make here is that you can't just call these ecosystems messy or fragmented. That's a little bit lazy, and it's not necessarily accurate. This is about specialization, right? Every time you get one of these new these consumer platforms that comes to market and there's a ton of investment driving a lot of innovation, you get a whole new crop of service providers popping up that are maybe specialized for that platform or extensions of some of the existing tools. But the point here is with so many different systems in place, you can get to a best-in-breed stack, but there's also a number of challenges. You have data fragmentation. You have systems incompatibility. You have disjointed approaches. You have inconsistent analytics, poor customer experience. And so the opportunity to integrate all these different tools and be the spine that connects them into a tightly knit data supply chain, moving data freely to and from each of these systems, that opportunity is massive, and that opportunity has never really existed before. And the fourth big point, I think boils down to customer experience. I think in the ongoing battle between the CMO and the CIO for budget control and influence, at the end of the day, it still boils down to customer experience, whether that's pre-purchase or post-purchase. Ultimately, you want to turn a casual user into a loyal user and turn that loyal user into an enthusiast and an advocate. And so the digital transformation that's happening across many brands and vendors in this room today, it's being built on the backs of the API economy. And then I would just add, the thing is that, a lot of the ad tech tactics like cookie sinks, those were never built to be sustainable. At best, they're short-term temporary hacks. At worst, they enable fraud and security problems. And then the last trend, the fifth trend, in a world where everybody's connected all the time, the technology required to help brands keep pace with their customers has to be fast, right? It can't be based on a batch system that takes hours or days to let data trickle in from the experience layer, whether that's the site or the app, down into a data warehouse and allow that to be your source of truth. The shift from data warehousing to Hadoop to now streaming data with vendors and solutions like Kafka and Spark and RabbitMQ ultimately allows you to create these real-time transmissions of data back and forth to accumulate that real-time view of the customer so that you can keep up with what they're doing regardless of the device. So this is what most companies' data stacks end up looking like. Data is generated when people go to the site or the app, and then eventually it gets pushed into a raw data storage system, and then there's multiple ETL jobs that will then push it into other systems, and then maybe you'll spin up a looker block to visualize the stuff, and this is by and large fine historically, but this actually doesn't work anymore. Data is generated in real time, and the expectation is, if we're talking about customer experience, that you know about me as the user up to that second or minute at the latest. And so it kind of brings us to where we are today, the opportunity to create a real-time source of truth. If the experience is based on two-day-old data or a week-old data, it's not going to work, right? And so the technology, as I mentioned before, that enables this, I mean, this stuff wasn't even around 5 years ago, right? So a lot of this stuff is new, and it's being commercialized by companies like mParticle. But when you think about what is the optimal data solution need to be, it really needs to have three pillars. It needs to be open. So it needs to connect to lots of different APIs, lots of different types of APIs, being able to write to those APIs as well as read from those APIs. It needs to be extensible. So it needs to get data back from those systems and accumulate data to a central profile that can then be shared out back to the integration partners. You get this snowball effect where there is a geometric accumulation of value where you're connecting more and more of these systems, whether it's your analytics tool, your marketing automation platform, your data warehouse, your paid advertising partner, wherever it is. And then lastly, it needs to be real time, because ultimately in the moments that matter, they don't last hours or they don't last days. They're fleeting moments, especially on your mobile device. So you need to be there, you need to be present. And ultimately, it's the difference between winning and losing. It's the difference between converting that customer from somebody who is anonymous or passive to being identified and being loyal to having them then shout on the mountaintops of social media saying, hey, this is a great brand experience, download the app or check out this website. And so why ultimately does it all matter? I think it matters to everybody in this room because for as long as I can remember, we've all been talking about the right ad to the right user at the right time, and that is as cliche as it gets. But how that's done is by getting the right data to the right system in real time. And you can't expect to do that if the right system isn't mapping the right identity across any different system all the time. And then just one quick bonus slide. I think this is certainly everybody's favorite topic this year, and I use everybody quite loosely. you know, a CDP is really the only way that you can address GDPR at scale. It can't be a system built on cookies that are unstable, because what happens if somebody expresses their right to be forgotten? They delete their cookies, they come back 2 days later, and they notice that you're targeting them. These are $20 million fines for every single instance. I mean, the stakes are super, super high. It also cannot be a system where there are shared identity spaces across customers. A core tenet of any CDP, including mParticle, is that all customer data has to be logically or physically segregated from all other customer, all of our other customers' customer data. And it has to be a real-time system. It has to be able to propagate those changes out and essentially send the mother of all delete commands out to the integrated network of partner integrations that you have, cascading that change down to every system. It can't be isolated in one or two tools. Again, the stakes are super high. So with that, hopefully you guys found this useful and informational. We have a booth out there. Feel free to come by, say hello. Hopefully everybody has a good rest of the show, and super excited for 2018. Thanks, everyone.